Hello friends. So we saw that the figural dimensions of the language destabilizes the stable cognitive fields. Language cannot provide grammatically indeterminate. We saw the example of the fall of Hyperion. The genitive in the title of very difficult to explain. Very difficult? No, it's not possible to explain because there's a stone, so many dimensions we can see. Now the next question is a stable cognitive field possible? Can language provide a stable cognitive field? The question is yes. The answer is yes and also no. Why? Because we have seen that in the last class we referred to trivium. What is trivium? Trivium is the most ancient, the most familiar and the most general model of language or model of linguistics, model of the science of linguistics. There are three functions of language. Trivium means three functions of language. One is grammar, the grammatical function. Second is the rhetoric function. And the third is logical function. Now before that, before getting into what this is, what do we mean by these things, we'll go through the sketch, or you can say the outline. Okay. So here, is a stable cognitive field possible? As in the classical trivium, grammar, rhetoric and logic, or dialectics, three functions of language. By establishing an interconnection between the trivium and the outside world, this is the problem, isn't it? Language cannot represent the outside world. Language is verbal, the outside world is non-verbal. So that is a problem now, but how to connect them? If you connect language with the outside world, then stable cognitive field is there already. Okay, then establishing an interconnection between the trivium and the outside world. Outside world is the quadrivium. Quadrivium, qua means four. Quadrivium, which are this, the non-verbal sciences of number, that is arithmetic, space, that is geometry, time, that is music, and motion, that is astronomy, it is possible. If you can connect trivium, science of language, with the science of, there was a discourse of science. If a discourse of language can be connected with the discourse of science that you find in this four non-verbal sciences, that is time is one, that is arithmetic, space is one, that is geometry, second one, third is motion, astronomy, and fourth is time, music, timing, time. Am I correct? What did I say? First one is grammar, so quadrivium first is number, arithmetics, second is motion, that is astronomy, third is space, geometry, fourth is time, that is music. Now if this connection can be established, interlinking it, yes, or interconnection, then naturally, what naturally will happen is a stable cognitive field. And this is the opinion of Paul Dimon, not me. Okay. And this is how I understand it. That's also. And then is it possible? Then there are two problems. First problem is the internal tension between the constituents of the trivium. There are three functions of life, three constituents. First one is grammar, second is rhetoric, and third is logic. Logic and grammar, they have got a very strong relationship. Logic. Grammar and logic, they go together. But rhetoric is not like that. Why is it like that? What is the role played by rhetoric? That we will see. Then second problem is, how to connect the trivium with the quadrivium? There should be passage, like passage to India. There has to be a passage from trivium to quadrivium. Who will provide that passage? That passage will be provided by the mathematical discourse, the mathematical discourse on the world, the mathematical discourse on the phenomenal world, the mathematical discourse on the outside world, outside of mathematics. And then this mathematical discourse will naturally give a passage to logic, one of the functions of the trivium. And logic, by deductive logic or inductive logic, will give a passage to the world outside. So the trivium can be connected through mathematical discourse, a mathematical discourse passing on the logical passing on to the world outside. The mathematical discourse especially, what happens is, it is rigorous. It is very rigorous, very strict. Especially language of the discourse of geometry. There you have got a concatenation, a linking together of time, space and number. Only motion is absent. So, what happens is that mathematical discourse on the world is very rigorous. It's very strict in that way. But it's a logic. For example, I'll tell you, deductive, I give an example of logic, and a syllogism. Syllogism is an argument. All men are mortal. Shakespeare is a man, so Shakespeare is mortal. Mortal. This is a very strict, you can say strict reasoning. There is nothing left, synthetic reasoning we say, nothing left, but no option for imagination there. When there is no option for imagination, what is produced by this syllogism is a stable cognitive field. All men are mortal, Shakespeare is a man, so Shakespeare is mortal. Perfect syllogism. Syllogism is called S-Y-L-L-O-G-I-S-M. Syllogism. It's an argument in deductive logic. Deductive logic. So, mathematical discourse takes you to logical discourse, and logical discourse takes you to the world, outside world. This is what Demon says in this essay. So that a link between the trivium and the quadrivium is possible by a mathematical discourse about the world, which gives a passage into logic and through logic to the phenomenal world. Geometrical reasoning is the most rigorous and infallible. Infallible means cannot make mistake. That is, no possibility of making infallible. That is, interconnection between the science of language, linguistics, and the science of the phenomenal world. Here, rhetoric has no role. Not he, but here. Sorry. Spelling mistake, isn't there? Here, rhetoric has no role. That's what you should see. If rhetoric is kept out from the trivium, then grammar and logic, they have got a very strong relationship. Grammar and logic. And grammar has got a power for extra, or we can say generalizing capacity, it has got. Grammar has a generalizing capacity. Making universal statements, so to say. So that's what we are trying to see, trying to find out. Whether this general statements can be made about textual production and textual reception. That is theory. All the things that we saw from Aristotle to T.S. Eliot, they are not theory. Because there you have got the foregrounding of the rhetoric and the figural language, both will take you to a field of indetermination. So there is no possibility of stable cognitive fields. Very well. So here you limit it. Here rhetoric has no role. Grammar helps logic. Understand? Grammar helps logic. And logic allows a passage to the world. Grammar and logic have a persistent symbiosis. Grammar and logic is one unit. Grammar helps logic. And logic helps a passage, gives a passage to the world outside. So this way, trivium and the outside world gets into or establishes a connection. And so mathematical discourse, from there logic. Logic is helped by grammar, then enter into the world outside. That is. Next is literariness, the use of language that foregrounds rhetoric over grammar and logic. A mathematical discourse, see, that takes you to logic. Logic and grammar, they have a very persistent symbiosis. Their rhetoric is out. But when you take literariness, idea of literariness, as we understand now, not after the advent of the theory as such, what happens is, their rhetoric is foregrounded over and above logic, grammar and logic. So, grammar and logic occupies a secondary position, or no position at all sometimes. Rhetoric is foregrounded in literariness. Therefore, what happens? On the other hand, as we have seen, this is what you call the epistemological thrust of the rhetoric into the semantic function of the language. Epistemological thrust of the rhetoric into the semantic function of language. Therefore, what happens is, you can see, the use of language that foregrounds rhetoric over grammar and logic, the inner balance of the trivium is disrupted. Inner balance. The trivium is balanced by grammar and logic. But here grammar and logic is thrown out. Then rhetoric comes in. So it is disrupted and the trivium is unable to connect with the phenomenal world. So no stable meaning. No grammar, no logic, only rhetoric. Rhetoric, the foregrounding of rhetoric over grammar and logic disrupts the balance of the trivium. So trivium is, we can say this is a virus, it acts like a virus. We can say that rhetoric is a virus, so to say, within this trivium. So trivium becomes, trivium is incapacitated. Trivium cannot function properly. And so trivium cannot connect with the, trivium, that means science of language, cannot connect itself with the science of the world. No interconnection is possible. But the other way around, then grammar and logic takes precedence over rhetoric, then through mathematical discourse you can enter into mathematical discourse of the world. Mathematical discourse of the world we are stressing because that is perfect reasoning, you know. See, geometrical reasoning, for example, if you take a triangle, how they describe that. And there's nothing left out for imagination. It is solid reasoning, rigorous reasoning. Therefore, what happens, you know, through mathematical discourse, you go to logic, and from logic, you go to the world outside. But in this case, when literariness comes, the balance is disrupted and it is But it becomes weak or unable, so sick. Kriyam becomes sick and unable to connect it with the world outside. That is the argument. And therefore, but he says this problem of foregrounding of rhetoric mostly happens in the process of reading. Therefore, so according to Paul Deman, resistance to theory is a resistance of reading. A resistance of reading where you should avoid rhetoric. Resistance to theory is a resistance of reading where you should avoid rhetoric. Only then you will be able to reach a stable cognitive field. That's what he said. That is the general idea of this. So resistance to theory is a resistance of reading. This is a problem of reading. What is a problem of reading? Literariness. What is literariness? Foregrounding of rhetoric over and above grammar and logic, which could provide solid knowledge, stable cognitive field. So this is the resistance to theory, so resistance of reading that should avoid rhetoric. That is interpretation and evaluation. Reading is interpretation and evaluation. So literary exegesis and critical evaluation being done now, that has absolutely no, that does not provide any, that there is no value. He says they have that that process that's going on now, it has got only the value of an anecdote, not even a theory. He says that is, rhetoric avoidance reading is the correct reading or the right reading. That is not possible now. That's not being done now. So they resist theory. So the resistance to theory is a resistance to reading. That is interpretation and critical evaluation. Understand? The right way of interpretation and the right way of critical evaluation. I hope you understand. So that is, by your introduction, now you'll go through this once again, then you'll understand it. I think that I'll be able to make things clearer for you now. So, is a stable cognitive field possible? That's the point. It is possible. Provided grammar and logic is given prominent place in the trivium. Trivium is the classical model of language, that is, rhetoric, logic and rhetoric, sorry, logic, grammar, rhetoric and logic. That's it. Trivium means three functions of language, three constituents of the science of language, three constituents of linguistics. This is the most ancient, the most familiar, the most general model, linguistic model you can say. Now there is, we meet the two tensions. One tension is, there is a tension within this trivium that is caused by the virus, as we have seen, rhetoric. Rhetoric makes the trivium unable to connect itself with the outside world. Because there, the inner balance is disrupted by the trivium. A second tension is how to connect the trivium with the knowledge of the outside world. The knowledge of the outside world is called the quadrivium or the non-verbal sciences, such as in the non-verbal world, I can say, that is number, that is arithmetic, space, that is geometry, time, that is music, motion, that is astronomy. This can be done only by logic. The inner connection between the trivium, science of language, and the science of the world can be done only through logic. And mathematical discourse about the world that leads to logical discourse, especially the language of geometry, says what happens is there is a, in language and geometry there is a natural concatenation. Concatenation means linking together. Katena means together, that is linked together. So cause a natural concatenation between space, number and time. So the arguments of geometry, discourses of geometry are infallible. And an interconnection between a science of language and the science of the phenomenal world is possible only through first mathematical discourse, and mathematical discourse entering into logical discourse, and logical discourse connecting with the trivium, the link between logic and natural sciences, there it is secure. So, first mathematical discourse, and logical, and then science of the world. So what happens is, you know, the tension within the trivium is literalness. Literalness is the use of language that foregrounds rhetoric or the grammatical and logical functions of the language. Understand? Rhetoric intervenes as a decisive, but it is unsettling elements, and therefore it disrupts the inner balance of the trivium and its outside extension to the world and its extension to the outside world. Since rhetoric disrupts the inner balance of the trivium, it resists, we can say, the extension of the trivium to the world outside. But that is not the case with the... In mathematical discourse, logic leading to passage of the world, rhetoric has no place. But literalness, only rhetoric has the most prominent place. And literalness, figure of dimensions of the language and so on that we saw yesterday in the title, the fall of Hyperion, you can see it's impossible to reach a stable cognitive field or connect trivium with the world outside. That's the point. To establish a connection between the trivium and the world outside, it is possible by the mathematical discourse. And mathematical discourse leads to logical. And the logical and mathematical discourse, they are very rigorous. What Paul Deman said, definitional logic. See, there rhetoric has no place. Here rhetoric takes over, in literalness, rhetoric takes over. There is no grammar, no logic. Grammar and logic have a persistent symbiosis. Grammatical and logical functions are coextensive. Grammar is an isotope of logic, it is. They are together, binding together. They help each other. That's the point. So theory, therefore he says, a theory grounded in grammar has the power to provide an underlying principle, yeah, that is generalization, of all cognitive, aesthetic and linguistic systems. That is what resistance theory is searching for. Is there an underlying principle for all aesthetic, cognitive and also linguistic systems? The other things what we see is only peripheral. Is there a textual code? Are there codes? That is, just one example I will give you from my understanding of this essay. When you say, what is that? April is the cruelest month. April is the cruelest month. That takes you by surprise. Immediately your thinking goes like this. April comparing to Joseph's April. What has happened? Why is it like that? But the underlying textual code, what is it? What is the underlying textual code to say like that? Or what is the underlying textual code of the wasteland? What is it? It is a loss. And finally, there is a gain. Where is it? Why? In what the thunder? Search. Shandi, Shandi, Shandi. So that is the underlying textual code. Rhetoric is not concerned about it, but grammar and logic, they are concerned about that. So unless and until you have a footing in grammar, a firm footing in grammar, or you can say it is a study of grammar is a precondition for what we say, for all or underlying principle of all cognitive, aesthetic and linguistic systems. So if there is a theory that is grounded in grammar, if the theoretical edifice is built on the foundations of grammar, definitely it will have a universal application. And here what happens is, everything is aesthetic response and rhetoric, figural dimensions of the language. The present theoreticians, right from Aristotle to past and present, Aristotle to T.S. Eliot and the so-called moderns, as we have seen, Marcel Proust and then Roland Barthes, all of them, they are not concerned about this. They are basing their theories on figural dimensions of language and the belief and the conviction that language carries ideas, or as we say, they confuse materiality of the signifier with the materiality of the signified. Understand that point? While language is epistemologically empty. And if you want to make it, if you want to fill that vacant place, what you need is help of grammar, logic, and process to that will take you to the world, the phenomenal world, a connection between the language, linguistic science and the phenomenal world. Hope you are following. Okay? And then what happens is linguistics is the one grounded in rhetoric. What will happen is, where there is no grammatical and logical function, that won't take you anywhere. Grammar helps logic, and logic allows a passage to the world. Study of grammar, as I already stated, is a precondition for all scientific and humanistic knowledge. A theory should be, naturally you will ask now, this is the fifth lecture, still I haven't told you. I haven't told you means I haven't come to that area. What is theory according to Paul Deman? Theory should be grounded on, scientific and humanistic knowledge. The basis is the study of grammar. I hope you understand now in this. If this theory is accepted, that is, the underlying principle of everything is all of it. There is a study of grammar is precondition for all scientific and humanistic knowledge. If you accept this, then what happens is, then what do you say? There is a continuity between theory and the phenomenal world. The present theory, so the inverted commas theory from Aristotle to T.S. Eliot, or I can say Barth and Proust and so on, they don't connect the theory with the phenomenal world. If you have to connect, only then you will have a stable knowledge. So if you have to connect theory with the phenomenal world, what is the precondition? That is, you must have a thorough knowledge, study of grammar. And that basis for all human, grammar, then logic, of course. Grammar takes you to logic. Already we have said grammar and logic, they have got a persistent symbiosis. So, you can easily create a passage to the phenomenal world. The tension between rhetoric and grammar, then as we said now, the tension between rhetoric and grammar and logic, this precipitates, so to say, the problem of reading, problem of right reading. Because if reading is not right, reading is interpretation. Reading also means a critical evaluation. Reading means literary exegesis. So if there is no rhetoric avoidance, or if you don't keep rhetoric as a, in the last class I told you, as an adjunct or a mere ornament, that's the thing. An adjunct or a mere ornament, then what will happen is that it will enter into the semantic epistemological, it will take up the epistemological role. The thrust of rhetoric, epistemological thrust of the rhetoric in the semantic function of the language. See that? Where it should be kept as an ornament or just an adjunct? What the existing practitioners of theory, what are they doing? They are accepting the role of rhetoric to provide stable meaning. That is where you find the conflict between theory and theory. Understand? Even the so-called methodological assumptions of reading, performative reading, speech act reading, even those techniques of reading, according to Paul Deman, avoid the object they want to achieve. They avoid the aim, you can say, or they avoid the goal that they want to achieve. What is the goal? The goal is to avoid rhetoric and then introduce a correct way of reading or right way of reading. But these speech act theories of reading or performative theories of reading, they also end up with the acceptance of rhetoric as the role of rhetoric, accepting the role of rhetoric in the semantic function of the language, whereas rhetoric should be kept just as an ornament or an adjunct. This is where the existing theories fail. They are still slaves of the rhetoric. They don't have a study, so to say, a serious study of the functions of grammar and logic, which definitely will take you to a stable cognitive field. I hope you understand. To summarize, you can say, trivium can provide a stable cognitive field. But there you have two problems. One is the inner balance of the trivium is disrupted by rhetoric, foregrounding of rhetoric. The other is how to connect trivium with quadrivium. To establish a connection between, a link between trivium and quadrivium, you can go through the mathematical discourses of the world or about the world. Then you take up the mathematical or take the help of mathematical discourses about the world, that will take you to logic. Logic and grammar, they are very closely connected. They have got a persistent symbiosis. So grammar will help logic to provide universal principles. That means to connect the science of language with the science of the world. If you successfully connect the science of world, science of language with the science of the world, then what happens is that you get a stable cognitive field. Hope I have made myself clear to you. This is my understanding of this essay by Paul Dimas, The Resistance to Theory. The backdrop of this, you should understand deconstruction. Deconstructive thinking and deconstructive philosophy. Although Paul Dimas doesn't explicitly state that I am a deconstructionist, his theory is that. As I already told you earlier, they used to meet who? The arch deconstructionist, that is Derrida, Jacques Derrida and Paul Dimas, they used to meet in Yale University. But what happens is both of them worked independently. So that point also you should keep in your mind when you are reading this essay. Of course, the essay is written in somewhat difficult language. No. Difficult means that for a postgraduate level, at the postgraduate level, I think it is difficult. So whatever I could explain, whatever I understood, I have tried to explain. I hope that you got the idea. So the idea is provide a stable cognitive field, and that is possible by grammar and logic. So study of grammar is very important for any humanistic or scientific knowledge about the world. And then what happens is you can connect the science of language with the science of the world, and that will of course end up in stable cognitive field. Bye. Have a nice day.